Welcome to the new sound of online radio. Welcome to the sound of Universal Broadcasting Network. Cause you make me feel like I've been locked out of heaven. A mix of today's hits and hard-to-find favorites. Combined with the most entertaining and intriguing talk anywhere. This is your sound. This is the sound of Universal Broadcasting Network at UPNradio.com.
It's time for the Bonnie Cher Show, a whirlwind of wit, wisdom, celebrity, and the boomer life. With a little bit of this, and a lot of that, and so much more you don't want to miss, here's Bonnie!
Well, hello, and welcome, old friends and new. From near and from afar, I'm Bonnie Cher. I'm your host, and I will be leading you through the worlds of entertainment, through the boomer generation, and of course, the world of type 1 diabetics. So thank you for tuning in. Please feel free to share your thoughts. It's a little pun there. You can share your thoughts. That was a bad pun. I apologize. It's early yet. I'll get better. And you can do so by calling us at 323-843-2826. Or you can follow the hashtag BSHER Radio on Twitter. Before we get this show on the road, I would like to acknowledge jazz great Wayne Cobham for my Super Duper Hero theme song. Thanks, Wayne. And of course, I'd like to acknowledge Corey Bowen of Crown and Anchor Jewelry. You can follow Corey Bowen, B-O-A-N, on Twitter for more information on the jewelry that they allow me to wear in exchange for this promotional message. When we come back, endocrinologist and nutritionist Danielle Nadeau. We'll be right back.
Your life story is more than the things you do. It's a story built on the moments you make today and the impact you have on others. How big is your story going to be? Live your legend.
And we're back. Dr. Nadeau, are you there? There you are.
That was very exciting. I like that rousing music and your charming personality. It's exciting to be here. Thanks for having me.
Well, that's a great start for me. Thanks. Do me a favor so I don't totally annihilate your last name. And let me hear how you say it.
You know, people say different ways, but I say Dan Netto, like Netto kind of thing. That's okay. The way I say it.
I mean, you're a swell fella. I'd like to get your name right.
Yeah, you got it. You're good.
Hey, that's what, yeah. Anyway, first of all, I'd like to thank you for sharing some of your most valuable time and coming in to have a little schmooze with me.
Well, I want to thank you for your show focusing in on type 1 diabetes. I mean, I think it's such an important topic. I work here at the Mary DeCallen Diabetes Center in Newport Beach, where really the focus is really on type 1 diabetes and trying to give them the best life we possibly can, trying to support them not only through better glucose control, but really focusing on those other things that people with type 1 diabetes face, having to do with psychosocial issues through Herbert family program that we have. We work hard to have a good transition program to help younger kids transition from pediatric care to adult care. And that's often very challenging. I'm sure you're in touch with so many people out there who are just struggling to get through the insurance issues, the issues around dating, the issues about driving cars. There's so many different things that are challenges that the rest of us just kind of take for granted. And to have you there talking about these important things, I think, is wonderful. So my thanks is to you for
thank you for saying the show that. And I was a teenager when I was diagnosed. I was 15. And that was an interesting time. I remember we weren't allowed to, like, date yet, but we would go out in groups. And these groups would be having cheeseburgers and fries and shakes. And there I was with my green salad and my zero-calorie salad dressing. We used the exchange system. That was just what it was. And what I see now, I mean, not to mention the advances, I used to save up urine in a great big old jug and pour off a little bit, hopefully that was the plan, and take it for study. We didn't have blood tests, you know, and then I remember I dropped a bottle of urine and can't cry over spilled urine.
Wow.
There's so many differences now.
Things have come a long ways, that's for sure. That's for sure. Thank God.
Well, I'm very grateful for all of that. The CGM, I mean, I loved the pump when it first came out, too. That, I mean, I still love the pump, but boy, the CGM, I think, has become a real game changer.
Boy, it sure has. You know, when I see people with type 1 diabetes, there's a few things, you know, that I may have introduced them to that they're thankful for. And without a doubt, it's this CGM for so many of these patients. It just makes them feel so much more comfortable, much less fearful of going to sleep at night, and help, you know, in terms of driving a car so much better there. So, yeah, absolutely, like you're saying, a total game changer for sure. Yeah.
Definitely. Well, there's something else that I'd like to talk to you about, which is your take. I realize that not only are you an MD, but you're also a nutritionist. And that's very rare. A great number of endos that I have met, as well as PCPs, but primarily the endos, nutrition, don't eat that. I mean, there's no real guideline. And your book, I think, could you talk to us a little bit about your ideas on diet?
Yeah, you know, I think thank you so much for asking. So back in 2002, a friend of mine, Jim Joseph, he was chief of the neuroscience tops, and Ann Underwood, who was a writer at Newsweek, we worked together to write a book called The Color Code, which is all about the health benefits of brightly colored fruits and vegetables, such as blueberries, such as spinach, such as tomatoes, and kind of put together all the research having to do with how these are potent antioxidants as well as potent anti-inflammatory agents. And my take is that for people who have diabetes, there are certain of these foods that are, well, it can be incorporated into the diet that can really be game changers for people. Right now, when Jim first did his research, he showed improvement in memory and motor skills in older animals by feeding them blueberries. And that research, thankfully, has progressed now, where we actually have human trials that show improvement in memory and motor skills. Some of the things like, remember when we were younger that we were told, well, you can never have new brain cells develop, kind of thing? Well, it turns out that you can develop new brain cells, and if you eat more blueberries, you will have more healthy new brain cells developing. So, and we reverse memory problems and improve motor skills, even in humans as well. So people with diabetes, I mean, because they have all this glucose floating around, they tend to have an accelerated oxidative damage and more inflammation going on. And the idea is that when you have more of these healthy foods, you can kind of slow down that inflammatory process and basically slow down the aging process that's occurring. So my approach is to, I think there's so many people out there with diabetes who are so focused on reducing carbs, they kind of miss out on some wonderful foods that are out there. I mean, you were mentioning salads, like to have plenty of salads. I think even at that early age, you were wise to be eating, you know, the salads, because greens have a lot of, you know, lutein and other components that are potent antioxidants and are very good for you. Blueberries, too. People may not appreciate a cup of blueberries only has 20 grams of carbohydrates, and yet is one of the most potent antioxidants that you possibly can have in your diet.
May I ask a question about blueberries? What's the difference between your basic garden variety blueberry and a wild blueberry? How wild where do they go to be wild?
Well, wild blueberries, I'll tell you what, I'm from Maine, okay? And Maine actually produces more blueberries than any other state or province, and most of those are wild blueberries. So you can't actually cultivate wild blueberries. You have to kind of have them in an area and then kind of promote their growth from year to year. They're smaller. They're more dense in color. They actually have more anthocyanins. They have a broader variety of these antioxidant agents called anthocyanins in them. They're just some of the most powerful antioxidants that we have. You know, I actually was flying on a plane one time up to Maine, and a guy who worked for a pie company says, well, we get the wild blueberries because they have most of the flavor. We throw the big berries in them because people expect to see those big blueberries in there, but the flavor comes, so they generally taste better, they're a little better for you. You can get them at some of the local stores. Wyman's from Maine has blueberries that I can find here at Mother's. We also have, Trader Joe's has wild blueberries from Quebec as well. So I would suggest if people haven't tried wild blueberries, and the frozen berries really contain all the antioxidant benefit of the fresh. So go ahead, you can save a lot of money by buying the frozen wild blueberries. And I think you'll find the taste is spectacular. I make smoothies in the morning. I take unsweetened almond milk. I throw a scoop of pea-based protein powder in there, sometimes some cocoa beans to give it a little bit of a crunch. And I'm telling you, Bonnie, these smoothies taste awesome. And I have literally thousands of people with diabetes who have blueberry smoothies for breakfast. And it's funny, I've never heard anybody say, oh, it's shooting my blood sugar up too high from having a blueberry smoothie like I just described. They usually find that, you know, they really feel good, having a blueberry smoothie in the morning. It's a great way to start the day.
Okay, here's another question.
Okay.
Must it be served cold? What if you wanted to make like a fresh blueberry soup? Does it make any difference
Yeah, it turns out that when you cook blueberries, you lose a lot of the benefit pretty fast, actually. Like if you were to make a blueberry pie and you ate it right away, you might still get some of the benefit.
I'll try.
but you probably are best having it on a regular basis. I mean, not to say, you know, once a week or, you know, once during the holidays, you know, have some blueberry pie, whatever. But on a regular basis, what you really want to have are fresh or frozen blueberries. And I'm sure you're very creative in the kitchen, so you have.
I'm very messy in the kitchen, if that was what you call creative.
No. What, say it again?
As I'm certainly very messy in the kitchen, so I must be.
I would say as well.
Oh, really? I have just been alerted to the fact that we need to take a little break right now, and we'll be back right after that. And I would like to know a lot more. And I guess one other question is, where does the protein come from in our diets? Hang on. We're going to come back to that. And we'll be back in, 60 seconds. See you then.
Since when did experience become something to hide? I say we own it. Lose all that negativity. Just let it go. It's just bad energy. Oh, and lose those terrible black balloons they give you on your 50th. What's up with that?
Hey, we hear you. That's why our members love AARP the magazine. It celebrates you with fun and provocative content, from lifestyle and entertainment to in-depth reporting. And it's just one of the great benefits of membership.
If you don't think this is right for me when you think AARP, then you don't know ARP. Get to know us at aarp.org/possibilities.
To be at peace with myself is the most prominent thing, and I am at peace with myself. I didn't deal this deck, I'm just playing the game. That's all. That's it. Meals on Wheels has given me a mode of freedom that I wouldn't have otherwise. I've been making sure they get the nutrition that I need, and it's a balanced meal. My name is Maurice McGriff, America. Let's do lunch.
Drop off a hot meal and say hello. Volunteer by donating your lunch break at americaletsdolunch.org.
And you are tuned to the Bonnie Scher Show, Boomer Life. We have the pleasure of speaking today with Dr. Daniel Nadeau. Join the conversation. I have an echo. It's gone. All right, so without the echo, I'm going to read off the phone number again, which is 1-323-843-2826. Or you can tweet the hashtag, and that's #, #BeShareRadio. So let's pick up where we left off before. Speak to me of blueberries and protein, please. I love blueberries.
well, blueberries don't themselves have a lot of
I know, so
protein, but I would say that when it comes to, let's say somebody's more interested in having more of a plant-based diet, you know, which we know is good for the planet, it's good for the person. How do you get enough protein? I think there's a couple of ways. One is to put a scoop of protein powder in with your smoothie in the morning. So that gives you 20 grams of protein. Then you might want to go ahead and, you know, have a salad for lunch and put some beans on top. And beans are a great source of protein as well. And then you use nuts as a snack. They don't really raise your blood sugar too much. And then to incorporate, you know, a little tofu, some green beans with dinner from time to time. You know, just have a whole foods diet. I think if a person is, you know, trying to be vegan and they're drinking Coke and they're having lettuce, they're not going to make it. But if you have a whole foods diet where you have whole grains, say quinoa and black beans, say, you know, you'll have plenty of protein coming in your diet as long as you have, you know, a whole grains diet. So I think that's you know, a good way to get plenty of protein. And, you know, one thing I've heard, a little saying that I like is the more beans you eat, the longer you're going to live. And I think that's for a couple of reasons, because beans are so low in saturated fat, so low in cholesterol. They have a lot of these anthocyanins and antioxidants that we're talking about. So to kind of incorporate them into your diet on a regular basis is a great thing. The other thing I mentioned, too, is there's so many wonderful meat-like meat substitutes, like Morningstar veggie sausage, for example. I find those taste exactly like sausage, and even tough old guys who you think would never, ever, you know, be satisfied with veggie sausage. If you serve them veggie sausage and say, guess what, I just served you veggie sausage, they'll never know the difference. So try that with some of your friends and see how they do with it. I think just by having a whole foods diet, having beans, legumes, nuts, green beans, and so on, I think you can get plenty of protein in your diet.
I've never been on a vegetarian nor a vegan diet, although I know that I don't tolerate red meat the way I used to. So that's left my, I know they're going to hate me in the world of chicken, but I do believe in saving every chicken I can. I don't particularly enjoy that. I'm not crazy about fish either. So the concept of eating that way is very interesting to me, you know?
And you know that, it's, yeah, when you move to a diet like this, you tend to have a much more diversified diet. you know, suddenly you're in an Indian restaurant and you're having the chana masala, which is, you know, chickpeas with a lot of spices, which are very good for you anyway. And, you know, you tend to kind of reach out and find more foods, more colorful foods that you're incorporating to your diet every day. And it tends to, as opposed to those kids who, like you mentioned earlier, are going out and having a burger for lunch every day or having, you know, french fries, this, that, and that. They seem to have the same food every day. You know, it kind of forces you to be a bit more creative and to check out some new restaurants that are around that are serving, you know, delightful, more vegetarian food. Yeah, not everybody has to be vegetarian, but it is a good thing to consider, and I think it's definitely possible for people with diabetes to really thrive, you know, being on more of a plant-based diet.
And this is how you eat also, not having diabetes? Are you does it satisfy you? There you go.
You know, I'm glad you mentioned that. I personally don't have diabetes, but I personally think that there's really one diet for everybody, one ideal diet that is more of a plant-based whole foods diet. And there doesn't have to be any separation between family members, one person.
Exactly. Yeah, that's what I was thinking about. Well, you've certainly got me interested in trying this out. I don't know why I wouldn't. And I'll be calling you occasionally to peel me a grape. But other than that.
Well, yeah, and, you know, for people who may have gastroparesis, what I find oftentimes are, like, smoothies are often well tolerated. Another thing might be a soup. And to have, for example, a soup that you've actually put through a blender kind of thing, that can be another thing that's very, very digesting. Really, you know, a lot of vegetables and a lot of fiber, a lot of good nutrients in there. And I think you can do, you know, people can do very well even with gastroparesis, for sure, with this type of approach, I think. It's a lot easier to make, you know, a bean soup that you've run through a blender. People don't typically think about, you know, putting meat through a blender kind of thing. But
because it's very messy when you screw it up.
Right.
Yeah, I've been there, done that. Okay. Doctor, let our audience know how they can follow you, how they can support you. And the book title again is, I have it right here, The Color Code, A Revolutionary Eating Plan for Optimum Health.
Yeah, well, I do lectures for the community. I do have one coming up in Newport Beach on Monday, November 13 at 6 p.m. And that talk is called Celebrating Culinary Diversity in Achieving Optimal Health, because I do think that, you know, to try and reach into culinary traditions and pull up some really wonderful traditions that people have had and to incorporate them into our diets is a fabulous thing for people, say, for example, of, let's say, a Persian heritage, to celebrate some of the wonderful foods that they have in their diet, or people with a Chinese heritage to pull up some wonderful.
And do people need to make reservations for this, or they can just show up?
Typically, people will make a reservation, and we get we usually can carry about 100 people. If they call 800-400-HOG, or that would be 4624. I think if they were to go to the HOG Hospital, HOAG website, and they would look, they could find this as a presentation coming up. So that's 1-800-400-HOG, and they can get, you know, they can register for the program that's coming up. And hopefully, I'm going to a 3-day nutrition conference this weekend. I'm hoping to pull in a whole lot of cutting edge ideas for people, you know, that really kind of lights their fire in terms of eating healthy.
Well, Listen, if you can get me on board, you can get anybody.
Well, you were
I've never really been accused of being a healthy eater. Just a little eater. Anything in moderation has been my thing, you know. But as I mature, I find that I don't tolerate food. It's the same way that I used to. In any case, I want to thank you so much again. It's been a pleasure. And please keep in touch with us. Let us know what's going on. We'll be happy to shout it out for you. And thank you on behalf of all of us, yeah, for a new colorful way of thinking about food.
Well, it's been lovely meeting you, Bonnie. I hope to talk to you again soon.
I hope so, too. Again, thank you very, very much. Now, as we go to break, I'd like to acknowledge the important work of the Diabetes Research Institute and encourage you to support their efforts. Millions of children and adults with diabetes dream of a cure for this devastating disease. We dream of living without the painful finger pricks and the insulin injections and the risk of the life-threatening complications. Scientists at the Diabetes Research Institute are working hard to make that dream a reality by finding a biological cure. They are advancing research to patients, and they're changing lives. So please visit them online at diabetesresearch.org. Our song of the day is coming up next, sort of right after this spot.
Type 1 diabetes can be living in anyone.
Type 1 diabetes is when your pancreas doesn't produce insulin. It's not caused by your diet. It's not caused by anything you did.
Type 1 diabetes can be very serious.
Blindness, amputation.
Learn more about type 1 diabetes.
Help support JDRF finding a cure.
T1D looks like my brother.
T1D looks like a friend.
Type 1 diabetes looks like me.
Look around, there's a wonderful world to be found. What a day. What a gassy little AM, what a day. Not at all like yesterday, M. It's the kind of morning that I'd like to keep. Clouds are yawning cause they're half asleep. What a day. What a swinging little sun up, what a day. Makes you kind of feel you're one up. And I know it's mine because I'm gonna burst. Hey, get in line because I saw it first. So when I say to you, cock-a-doodly-doo, get up and out of my way. What a day. What a day. What a groovy new aurora, what a day. What a fascinating aura, Mr. Sun is dancing like a red balloon. Still romancing with the fading moon. What a day, what a twinkling little twilight, what a day. Like that great 4th of July night, I can roar like thunder if I take the urge. Throw me under and I'll still emerge with a song in my heart. I can make a new start and fall for all I survey. What a day! What a day! What a nifty little number. Awaken from my slumber with a brand new feeling and a brand new mood. I got me a brand new attitude. So when I say to you, cock-a-doodly, a what? Get up, get out of my way. What a day! Look around, wonderful world to be found. What a day.
That was What a Day, sung by the wonderful Barbara McNair. Well, welcome back to the Bonnie Share Show, Boomer Life. And my co-host for this segment is my friend and a very savvy diabetic, ladies and gentlemen. This is Joanne Milo. She is, yes, thanks. Oh, she's lit up beautifully. I love it. And Joanne is from right here in the great state of California. So welcome back, Joanne.
Thank you, Bonna. And before I say anything, is this coming through clearly?
Yes.
Okay. Before I do anything, I just want to wish you happy anniversary. 3 years bringing all this information to people. We all feel like in the diabetes world, we get a touch of show business, and you get
and I get a touch of diabetes.
and you bring a lot of information from throughout the world, and it's wonderful. So thank you so much for what you do.
Thank you for saying that. And listen, it's only our lives.
And you'll see, I have Hey Buddy in my background. He's sleeping, but he wanted to listen. And I also wanted to say that I have seen Dr. Nadeau as a patient because I wanted to understand a plant-based diet. I had seen a documentary called What the Health. My husband and I watched it, and we sat there and said, we need to try this. And we've been 95% vegan for the last 5 or 6 weeks. And it's been an interesting transition and not at all feeling like I'm missing anything. And we actually he suggested the pea protein. We use that in shakes. My blood sugar is under good control and the food is good. So it's been an interesting trial, and we'll certainly be at his talk on November 13th. So he's a good guy.
He really is. Okay. I like the way he laid it out. It makes sense. Mm-hmm. Heaven forbid, you know.
Right.
But
right. Well,
I know that you've been living with type 1 for, what is it, 40-something years now?
It's closing in on 53.
Oh, well, I was only a little off. Yeah. I know. It just went. And I know that you stay very close and involved in all of the new, the looping and the stuff. So that the audience understands, the last time Joanne was with me, we were having some technical difficulties, and this brilliant woman wound up saying, so we're going to go back in time, and we are going to cover a lot of the same things, which are basically, we try and stay very positive. I think both of us and most T1s to the best of our ability, but sometimes it's really damn tough to remain positive when you see things sort of barreling out of your control. One of the reasons I started this show was that I found that there was a lot of speak about children with diabetes, but there was very little about those of us who have been in the trenches, as it were, for 20, 30, 40, 50. I read yesterday on Facebook a man with 72 years of type 1 behind him. And everybody, not everybody, but a lot of people, everything's great and wonderful. It's hard for me to believe that if it's true, great. But there are things that come to play the longer you have the disease, and it isn't an issue of wrapping yourself, why didn't I do this better? You did what you did to survive. And time takes a toll. So having said that, Joanne, what would you like to bring to the community today?
It's really interesting, Bonnie. I run a support group in Orange County, and we actually had a new member join us for an Afrezza challenge where we had breakfast, ate the highest carbs we could, and took Afrezza and tracked our blood sugars after that. He had never been around other type 1s, and he was maybe in his early 60s. And he had most of the new technology, but he kept shaking his head going, wow, you all have type 1? And there's a sense that you sometimes just want to touch others and say, you have this too? What I think I'm noticing, and it's really fascinating to me, is, and maybe this is what you have to do with a chronic disease that's treacherous, is live a lot in denial. And I have one or two friends who don't live in denial, and I was having lunch with Sharon this week, and we got together, and I said, I hate this. I just hate it. I'm tired of it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm not depressed. I'm tired of it. And it is such a constant. My husband sometimes wonders what takes me so long during the day. Well, I have to check my blood sugar. I have to calibrate my Dexcom. I have to change an infusion set. There's so much you do that's time built in.
It's a full-time job.
It's probably a good 50 minutes a day, and it's throughout the day, and more if you have to see doctors or deal with insurance. And then there's the whole scope of type 1s who just kind of do live in denial, and my heart hurts a little bit for that, because I want to say, watch out, danger, danger. But everyone has to cope with it the way they can. And then we deal, you know this as well as I do, we deal with a medical community. Oh, how do I say this kindly? I can't. They're ignorant. They are, many of them are traditional medical doctors. They were trained traditionally. Saw someone who's well-regarded in my community, and she said, well, when I was in medical school, which might have been 25 years ago, there were two types of insulin. Is that still true? And I didn't know what to say. And I said, and she said, which one are you on? Saw another doctor, and her chief nurse said, do you have the good kind or the bad kind? And I know we joke about that, and I was so surprised that it was actually true. Someone actually asked me that.
Other question is, the other kind's going to kill you? Yeah.
Or I had an uncle who. And I very often, because I like to teach, I think I'm an inborn teacher, I want to educate. And one of my doctors says, don't do it. Just don't do it. We really don't have time to learn. And he was being, I think, terribly honest. But they are treating us as a whole person. Diabetes touches so many parts, and absolutely, it's hard to get a team. And you know, don't teach doctors. Don't help them understand. It's foreign to me.
Don't confuse me with facts. My mind is made up. Yeah.
No, that's actually true.
Yes.
So I went back to the doctor who told me I was not under good control. And I said, my A1C is in the low sixes. She goes, that's what I mean. And I was like, okay. So I went back after I saw another endocrinologist who had said to me, I can't improve upon this. You're doing a great job. And I told her that. And she goes, well, okay, whatever. And it's very frustrating because we need the medical community. If I could write my own lab slips.
I knew you were going to say.
Prescriptions. I would love someone to consult with, but please let me go get my labs and let me get the results. I won't get hysterical. I just need the data, which is probably what I like so much about the do-it-yourself community, the We Are Not Waiting group, because they're tired of not having the data, and they are making amazing progress. You know, I'm on the closed loop.
Yeah, you're my loopy friend, I know.
There's several of us now going on it that are my age group or have had diabetes.
Well, my hat's off to you. I got to tell you, I would probably program my iPhone to deliver insulin. I get so confused. There are too many things going on. But it is, I mean, I clearly understand the need for we're not waiting anymore. And if it's possible, and go ahead on, because I'm, you know, I don't know about anybody else who's still waiting on the CGM for the 670. You know, there was a big push, so you guys are doing it yourself, and you're the only ones doing it.
There's actually some hot news that came out over the weekend, and I just about jumped off my chair. The group has been trying to be able to use Omnipod instead of just Medtronic
for the closed loop.
And some hackers, and I think they were in Sweden, broke the code. They're in. Which means they need some more time to clarify the handshakes internally, but that means they're in, which means we don't have to wait till 2019 to use an Omnipod and to be severely limited to an old insulin pump. Why Omnipod and any of the pump companies just don't open the doors surprises me. Dana pumps are open architecture. That's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
What are we going to do wrong with it? We're going to actually use it to save our lives. So please let me have the technology. So I see it as exciting. I'm going to a focus group next week for new infusion sets that actually don't irritate the skin. And so there's stuff going on out here. But my drive, like yours, is where's the cure? And has been since 1970.
It's only five years away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
In five years. Right. All that happened to me in 5 years is I got 5 years older.
And a little more frustrated.
A little more frustrated. Yeah, that's for sure.
I don't know if I expect there'll be a cure in my lifetime, but I see major advances, and I see in our backyard amazing research, which excites me. I just get urgent. Like I know you know that feeling. May I please get better technology? Can I get a glucose meter that is accurate?
And can I get an insurance company that's going to figure out how to pay for this? I've been approved 100% and I've got 100% of nothing.
Right. Or Medicare that says you can't use your smartphone.
That's because they figure people over 65 can't figure out how to use two things at once. Mm.
I think they don't want to think they have to pay for it, but that's another whole story. But
we could do this for hours, and we will. Yes. But for today, I am going to let you go and say thank you, as always, for sharing the truth. That's what we're here to do, is talk the truth. One great thing about having diabetes, and I have found one, is, and especially in these last years, is meeting some absolutely fantastic people that even if they didn't have diabetes, I'd want to know.
Thank you so much.
We'll keep in touch. Tell people about the Savvy Diabetic and how they can follow you and learn from you and ask you questions.
My website is thesavvydiabetic.com. I just upgraded it. It's really cool. Sign up for updates. And I'm about to put out a major blog on diet and what should you eat and how do you figure it out. So watch for that, and you can send me an email through the site. And thank you for listening.
Joanne, thank you for being a part of this. See you
soon.
Happy
anniversary, baby.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
We are quite a group, aren't we? That's our Joanne Milo. Let's see. Next coming up, we did that. Oh, I know what I want to let you know about. You know, if any of our other type 1 diabetics would like to be on the show, share their stories, maybe some information, it's very simple. Write me. You can send me an email at bonnie@bonnieshearer.com. That's about how easy that goes. And we'll find a date, and we'll have you on the show as well. Now, next up, Boomer News. Today's Boomer News comes to us from the Wall Street Journal. The economic impact when baby boomers retire. And views from my soapbox. Back in 60 seconds.
The decision to retire is one of the most important personal financial decisions anyone can make. Well, it turns out that it also has a profound macroeconomic impact that we are only now beginning to appreciate. Economists have known for a long time that as the U.S. population ages, it'll tend to slow down economic growth just because we'll have a smaller workforce as a result. But there's new evidence that suggests there's another impact on the economy that's potentially even more important. Because older workers tend to be the most knowledgeable and the most experienced, when they retire, that hurts the productivity of everybody left behind. And that drags on the economy through productivity growth. These findings come from a new economic research paper that just came out in the last week. The economists looked at all 50 states, they looked at the ones that aged faster, and they found that in those states, economic growth slowed more. About a third of the slowdown was because their workforce wasn't growing as quickly, but the rest of it was because the remaining workers just weren't as productive. You know, this kind of makes sense. Older workers aren't just the ones who are most experienced and capable, they also tend to make the people around them more capable and more confident and knowledgeable about how to do their jobs. If you look around the country right now, there are employers from coast to coast grappling with the fact that some of their most experienced employees are now coming up on retirement and they're very worried about how to replace them. There's a lot of sort of tribal knowledge that you acquire on the job that you cannot simply teach in college. The country as a whole needs to come to grips with this, because if it doesn't, it's facing a double whammy from the aging of the population. This, I think, adds an extra impetus to a lot of the discussion now that we should do more to extend retirement ages, both in private pensions and in Social Security.
And now, the views from my soapbox, which is my take on who I believe got it right and who should really be ashamed of themselves. So, as both of my guests mentioned, today is the first day of year number 3 of the Bonnie Shearer Show Boomer Life. I am thrilled that we've been able to give you a show which you enjoy, which is meaningful to you. And if it wasn't for my viewers and listeners, this never would have happened. So, to all of you, and I thank you for being loyal. And here we go into year number 3. I think that's very cool. Now, my shout down. Well, this is going to come as no surprise that what I'm shouting down today is the Graham Cassidy bill. As far as I'm concerned, it's akin to playing Russian roulette with the lives of millions of people. And it's tough enough just to be a human. So yeah, call your senators, please, and tell them that this just isn't the right thing to do. So I pray for that. So now before we say goodbye, I would like to thank my guests today, Dr. Daniel Nadeau and Joanne Milo. And again, as it is the start of our third year, I need to thank my producer, Jarvis Essex. And I have a wonderful friend who's come in to help me out and is sort of interning for me, although this is no intern. This is Tony Johnson. And so this is my team and my crew. And we want to say thank you. And that's our show. And I hope you return next week for another 50-minute trip through the land of Bonnie, Boomers, and the T1D community. Until then, please visit BonnieShearer.com. Follow the number one Bonnie Shearer on Twitter. And like the Bonnie Sings Lena, L-E-N-A, Facebook fan page. Now, after this amount of time, most of you are aware of the very special friendship that I had with the late Sammy Davis Jr. I still can't quite say those words. He was my mentor and he was my friend. And so I like to acknowledge Sammy on every show and sort of, you know, Carol Burnett style with a wink and a wave and a thank you very much, Mr. D. And so until next week, have a Lashana Tova, Happy New Year, and Happy World Peace Day. Bye-bye.